I want to take 2 Timothy, the first chapter and the 12th verse. For the which cause I also suffer these things, nevertheless I'm not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. Someday, I or my wife is going to write a book, I'm sure, on 2 Timothy, and we're going to call it A Letter from Death Row, because Paul was on death row writing to young Timothy. He was in Rome, and he was awaiting death, and he was writing some instructions of encouragement and some instructions of warning to young Timothy. And he used this passage that I would like to use in several places as it's found in other parts of the scriptures. Those things that I have committed unto the Lord. It literally means to roll upon the Lord. To roll upon the Lord. Now what do we roll on the Lord? First, we roll ourselves. Psalm 22:8. He trusted on the Lord. That word trust, literally, in Hebrew, if you look it up in your concordance, means he rolled himself on the Lord. We are to roll our minds on the Lord. There's a great discipline, as we find in the scriptures, about the mind. And many of us are undisciplined people when it comes to reading, when it comes to study. I've been working on a book on the Holy Spirit while I've been away. And there's a great discipline in doing this writing and this studying on the subject of the Holy Spirit. And as I have been studying, I don't know whether I'll publish it or not, but it's been a great blessing to me. It's not only blessed me, but I'm sure it has changed my life in many ways. As I have studied the ministry of the Holy Spirit from Genesis to Revelation. And so we roll ourselves, we roll our minds upon the Lord. And how many of us have disciplined minds? Discipline enough to turn off the television. Discipline enough to read some of the top books that are coming out. Discipline enough to pick up the scriptures every morning and read them. It was my father-in-law's practice to spend 2 to 3 hours every morning, and he was a busy doctor and had a big hospital. But he spent that time every morning studying the scriptures. And when my father-in-law died, he was a virtual walking biblical encyclopedia, as many of you knew him to be. And I believe that this is something that we ought to cultivate in our lives as habit. And if you get in the habit of starting your devotional life before breakfast and take the Christian Chinese saying, no Bible, no breakfast, and get into that habit, it'll become just as much a habit to you as a cup of coffee. Now, what I like to do is to prop myself up in bed in the morning before I get up and sip coffee along with my Bible reading and spend a period of time just in soaking up the scriptures, not preparing a sermon, not preparing for a book, not preparing for an article, just feeding my own soul upon the Word of God and feeding my mind. And somehow this changes the whole day. And then the second thing, I think, is our, what is called in Scripture, our soul, which I think involves our intellect, our emotions, and our will. All of this totally, completely yielded to Christ, rolling upon him. And then, of course, our body, our bodily functions, whether it be sex or whatever it is, we give it to God. Whatever the problem is, wherever the area that we haven't committed in our bodies, we give it to him, our hands, our feet, every member of our body, under the control of Christ. And then, of course, our spirits. And we read the 22nd Psalm, and we see something of the spirit of our Lord Jesus suffering on that cross for our sins. And that's the part of us that is in contact with God and makes us different than the animals. And we are in contact, and we're praying without ceasing, and the fellowship is never broken. And it's a wonderful thing to me that we can have fellowship with God every moment of the day. And we don't have to be preaching. We don't have to even be studying the scriptures. You can be doing your work right here in the office, whatever, however menial it may be. And I found another thing in studying the gifts of the Spirit. I believe that every single believer has a gift from the Holy Spirit. We have been baptized into the body of Christ, every one of us. And we have been given a gift. Now you say, well, I don't know what my gift is. Well, I think if I were you, I would evaluate your own selves, your own lives, your own abilities, your own training, and I would say, now, Lord, I believe I do have a gift here. And I read about a pastor. In fact, I read about a number of pastors that have passed out slips of paper to his congregation. He said, take this paper home, and next week, bring it back, and on there, after a week of prayer, tell us what your gift from the Holy Spirit is. Now, sometimes it's a talent that God will spiritualize and make it into a gift, but sometimes it's just a gift that God gives. It's the sovereign will of God saying, Jim, Bill, Susie, Mary, Jean, this is your gift. Or it may be a multiplicity of gifts. The Apostle Paul had many gifts. There are 20 gifts listed in the four places where the gifts are listed in the New Testament. And you may have one of those, or this may be a sample list of the gifts. And there's the gift of music, which is not listed there. And there are other gifts that we could think of. So the pastor gets all of these letters back, and these pieces of paper back, and he looks at them, and he sees all these people with these various gifts. And he sees that they're not using their gift. And Paul said, stir up the gift that's within you. What is your gift? We ought to be using that gift to the best of our ability under the direction of the Holy Spirit. Now, of course, there's one other thing that I believe is more important than the gifts. And if I had a choice, I would rather be a fruit bearer of love and joy and peace and long-suffering and all of that great cluster of nine fruits that are listed in Galatians 5. And every one of us here in this office can bear fruit. And all the fruit culminates in the one that is mentioned in the 13th of 1 Corinthians, love. And that's a chapter we ought to all memorize. And we ought to all say it every day to ourselves before we go to work. Everybody would be smiling all day long. Irritations would be at a minimum. Friction would be at a minimum. And I suppose it is at a minimum compared to most offices. And thank God for that. But what a wonderful thing it would be. Then the second thing we commit is found in Job 5:8. Unto God would I commit my cause. What is our cause? Our cause is a biblical cause. Our cause is the evangelization of the world. Because we believe that somehow in a very strange way that is tied to the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Because he said, this gospel shall be preached into all the world for a witness, and then shall the end come. Now, we don't quite understand that, but there it is. That when we evangelize and when we go out as soul winners, we're really helping to bring back the Lord Jesus Christ. I don't have time to go into what I think about that or when I think the Lord is coming and all of that at this time, but simply to impress upon you the importance of the work that we're doing. Our cause is evangelism. Are we going to see the world converted to Christ? No. We are going to see a diminishing minority in the world that believes. Our job is to vindicate the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ. My job in New York City and Los Angeles and Detroit and Chicago, and your job in helping me do it and helping all of us do it, is to vindicate the righteousness of Christ so that not a person in those areas will be able to stand at the judgment and say, I never heard. The increase is God's. The results are God's. I have less and less confidence in statistics all the time. God is keeping the statistics. And our job is to be faithful. And God is calling out a people for his name from all the races, from all the world. And we have come to the conclusion after our little research in along the borders of China that the church in China today is double what it was when the missionaries left. That God is at work mightily in China. And God is at work in Eastern Europe. For example, just what we know in Romania, the Baptists have doubled in the last 10 years. That's openly what we know. We don't know the quiet underground Solzhenitsyns, of which there must be hundreds and thousands throughout the Soviet Union. or the Alleluia Stalins who said, I can no longer live in a world without God. They won't get out, but they're there. And they'll be at the judgment seat of Christ, and they'll be in heaven. It's the Lord's doing, and it's marvelous in our sight. And then the third thing, rolling our burdens upon the Lord. Did you see on the front page of the paper yesterday, Ann Landis had taken a poll of 10,000 women who had children, and 70% said they were sorry they had the children. They say that now the statistics have already reached the point of one out of every two marriages are broken in America. The pressure upon the home is unbelievable today, and you know what I'm talking about. You that are married, you that are unmarried. The greatest percentage in population in the United States today has now crossed the line into the singles group. And many of those people say, we don't ever want to get married. Well, when I see some of the marriages and the problems they're facing, if I were not a Christian, I might take that same point of view. But marriage today as a Christian is totally different. We are a colony living in a hostile world to what we believe. And yet in our homes today, Satan has entered. He comes in a thousand subtle ways because the world puts its pressure upon us. Through the television set, it gradually breaks down what we believe to be right and wrong, until after a while we're no longer sure what we believe to be right and what is wrong. Everything becomes relative. And the burdens multiply because, you see, we're breaking a universal law. We are breaking a law that God has put in the very nature of things. He's put into the very nature of civilization. We are breaking God's law, and we as Christians become guilty of it, and the burdens come. What is your burden? Is it too heavy to bear? Cast thy burden upon the Lord, and he shall sustain thee. Psalm 55:22. He shall sustain thee. Now, it's easy for me to say that. You say, Billy, it's easy for you. You just don't know. Well, I can tell you I do know. I know a lot of burdens that I've had to carry. A lot of them you know about. A lot of them you don't know about. A lot of times you say, well, Billy, do you ever get discouraged? Yes. Well, do you ever feel like sort of giving up? Yes, 1,000 times. Well, do you ever have these feelings that I get of just, well, I just, yes, I get them all. But it's a wonderful thing to just roll it over on the Lord. And you know, sometimes it takes really an act of faith. I remember one time years ago, I got so that when I prayed, it seemed that I didn't get anywhere in my prayers. My prayers were just going up to the sky and coming back. And heavens were brass. And I wrote my mother about it. And I said, Mother, it seems like I'm not getting anywhere in my prayers. And she wrote me back. And she said, well, son, she said, sometimes when the fog gets the heaviest and the clouds get the lowest, and it seems that God is not there, that's the moment he's the closest. And said, reach up by faith, and you'll sense his hand. And I remember getting on my knees, and I reached up by faith. And there was God. And I rolled that burden on him. And he took it. And then we roll our way on the Lord. Psalm 37:5. Commit thy way unto the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. Commit thy way. Your past. I had a man come to me day before yesterday at the Mayo Clinic, and he had a block of sins a mile long, and he said, Billy, do you believe God can forgive me? I said, yes, sir. The blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanseth from all sin. But he said, I've got some that are even worse than I've told you. I said, God can forgive you of every sin because of what Christ did on the cross. I said, did you know that I'm going to heaven not because I'm good? Really, he said. I said, yes. He said, I'm going because of what Jesus did on the cross for me. I'm going by the grace of God. I have no other claim to heaven except the grace of God in Jesus Christ and the blood that was shed on that cross. I can commit my past. I can commit my present. I can commit my future to him. And then, fifthly and lastly,
we commit our works.
Psalm 16:3, commit or roll thy works unto the Lord, and thy purposes shall be achieved. What are our purposes? They will be achieved if we roll them on the Lord. The works that we've done, the bad works, the good works, the incomplete works, the inadequate works, what we need to get done that we can't seem to get done, what we've left undone, what we couldn't get done, what we should do, all these things, we can roll upon Him. Now, we took this organization a long time ago, and we rolled it on the Lord. We said, Lord, this is your association. This is your group of people. This is your ministry. This is your work. You've called us together as a team. Now, when we say team, I really don't like that word any longer. I don't know how we can improve on it. But I don't mean the team. The team is the team that's traveling. I don't mean that anymore. I mean all of you are on the team. We're all the same group of people working together. We're disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ. We're working for Him. He's chairman of the board. He's the president. He's the boss. We're energized by the Holy Spirit. And we're to do our work under the superintendency of the Holy Spirit, who gives leadership. Some people say when you have the church, you shouldn't have any organization. Well, I find elders and deacons and bishops and so forth listed in the scriptures, and they had some organization in the early church. You have to have organization. You have to have leadership. And so you have heads of departments and you have leaders. This is all scriptural. But we all are a team. We all are a part of it, working together for one purpose, the evangelization of the world. Now we're living at a very critical moment in history. What's happening in the world? The world is closing in around us. Just a few bombs that they already have out there could knock us right out. And some people feel that there will come a day when they say, all right, surrender, or you're blown up. And that we have been so now demoralized and so brainwashed that we will say, oh, yes, we'll surrender. We'd rather be red than dead. Now, whether that's the way it's going to go or whether it's going to be a gradual thing or not, I don't know. But I believe that God today is getting Christians ready for persecution. Whichever way it goes, whether it goes a legal way, an illegal way, a peaceful way, or a war way, Christians and Jews are in for trouble. And we better get ready for it. And we can roll that upon the Lord. Didn't He predict it? Isn't that what the 21st chapter of Luke's all about, and the 13th of Mark and the 24th of Matthew? Didn't He say there would be all these things? I spoke about earthquakes. We went down to Guatemala 2 weeks ago. And this is the way it's going to be worldwide someday. And we can look at Guatemala and we can say, well, Lord, thank you for preserving us, but in some form or another, it's going to hit us. And we better be ready for the earthquakes. Spiritual earthquakes, moral earthquakes, political earthquakes, economic earthquakes that are going to hit us in the years to come. But we can roll all of it on the Lord.